Hi, Hank.
Hello. Hi.
Are you?
I'm doing well. What about you?
I'm good.
Good.
I see you are waiting for so long for the session. So, what's the time out there?
Excuse me?
I'm just asking, like, what's the time out there at your place?
Oh, what is the time? For me, it is 11:27.
Oh, great.
Almost
So,
time for lunch for me.
okay. So, just before you, we had Ritesh. So you're probably the last speaker for our whole conference. So I hope like the session will be interactive and people will definitely love it. So over to you, Hank.
Thank you.
So Hank, you can quickly introduce about yourself and then you can take it forward.
Good, yes. So my name is Henk Boelman and I'm a cloud advocate at Microsoft. I joined Microsoft around 6 months ago. And before that, I used to work at a small startup in the Netherlands where we built machine learning solutions. And for that, we used Azure Machine Learning Service, which I'm going to talk about today. So Azure Machine Learning Service is this really great tool that helps you work together on machine learning projects. And it can be really helpful when you have to work as a team and share your environments. So I live in the Netherlands and I give a lot of presentations about Azure Machine Learning. So anything you want to know more?
I think Hank, you have covered most of your introductory part, so you can start your session now.
Good. I've shared my screen, I think.
Okay, sure. I'm just putting it on the screen.
Perfect. I see it. So hi everyone, and thank you so much for joining this conference and taking the time to listen to me about talking to you about Azure Machine Learning with the Python SDK to train PyTorch models at scale. So what are we going to do in this presentation? We're going to see what is out there on Azure if it is concerning machine learning. And we're going to build a Simpsons classifier using Azure Machine Learning Service and deploy that model into the cloud. So let's dive into machine learning on Azure. So there are five pillars. I always like to see them as five pillars. So our top layer are our sophisticated pre-trained models. And other words for that are Microsoft Cognitive Services. And that are machine learning models that are trained and maintained and developed by Microsoft and exposed to APIs for you as a developer to use. If you want to dive in a little bit deeper, you can train everything on our cloud. You can train PyTorch models, TensorFlow models, Keras, Onyx. It doesn't matter, it all works. We can help you a little bit to make things a little bit easier. We have Azure Databricks, Azure Machine Learning Service, which we're going to dive in a little bit later, and then our machine learning virtual machines. So with one click, you can say deploy and you get a machine completely pre-installed with you. And I think we all know how hard it can be to set up all your training frameworks like TensorFlow, PyTorch, this version of Python with these dependencies. It is all arranged and pre-installed on that virtual machine for you. So we also have, of course, a lot of CPUs and GPUs in the cloud, which will actually help you accelerate your training. And then we can pick up your models and deploy them. We can give them to you so you can run them on-prem or in your applications or on your phones. We can run them in the cloud for you and bring them to edge devices using IoT Edge. I'm going to briefly tip Cognitive Services because they are great and they will work for many scenarios. So Cognitive Services are pre-trained models that live in the cloud, and some of them you can pick up and deploy to the edge. So for instance, if you want to run face detection locally in your own network, you can get a container having the face API in it and deploy it to your containers. So these Cognitive Services are divided in four regions. So we have vision, speech, language, and knowledge. So vision is there to make your application see. Speech is there to make your application talk and listen to you. Language to understand what is being spoken, and knowledge to if you want to tap into the knowledge of the internet. But today we're not going to talk about how to call an API. we're actually going to build a machine learning model ourselves using Azure Machine Learning Studio. So Azure Machine Learning Studio, previously called Azure Machine Learning Service, and sometimes even referred as just Azure Machine Learning, is a fully managed cloud service that enables you to easily build, deploy, and share your machine learning projects. And we are going to do that with a fun example, like is it Homer, is it Marge, or a simple PyTorch model. And for that, we're going to use my Simpsons Lego dataset. So I have for all these Lego figures, I took like around 50 pictures from each, and I use that as a training data set. So you can use also that data set if you want to play around with it. So what are we going to use? We're going to use Azure Machine Learning. We're going to use the PyTorch framework. We're going to use a GPU cluster, and we're going to deploy that model into the cloud. And this is how the flow should look like. So we have a data scientist team that will actually train and figure out a model and delivers that model to model management. We have a group of developers that will build software around the model using their favorite tools, using version control, using build pipelines, and probably wrap it up in a Docker container. But it can even be like a mobile app. And then we have an operations team that will actually have to operationalize the model. And they can use, for instance, deploy pipelines for it and deploy it to Azure Kubernetes service. But if you build a machine learning model and wrap it in a Docker container, from an operations perspective, it is just deploying a container. And then, of course, we have a client that will actually call the API. So what do we need to do if we want to get started with Azure Machine Learning Service? We first have to prepare our environment. Then we can start experimenting with our model and with our data. And when we're done, we can actually deploy this model to production. So how do we prepare an environment? We can do it in three different ways. We can go to the Azure portal. We can use Visual Studio Code, or we can do it from Jupyter Notebooks or Azure Notebooks. My preferred way is always do it in an Azure Notebook, because then you can actually version your code. So this is how it looks. We have an Azure Notebook that is basically a Jupyter Notebook that runs in the cloud for you and has a lot of dependencies for you already pre-installed. So from this point, we're going to dive in some Python code, and I will actually show you how you can set it up from code. So the first thing you need to do is, after you have an Azure subscription, is create your workspace. Before that, you still have to install the Azure ML SDK Python package. So you say workspace create, you give it a name, point to your subscription ID, point to your resource group, and tell where you want to have this resource deployed. When you have done that, you can write out a config file. That config file you can check into your Git repository, and everyone else can connect to your workspace by just loading that configuration file saying workspace from config. So no need to check in any credentials. And this is what you get. So you see it lives outside the Azure portal. So you go to ml.azure.com, and there you can connect to your workspace. So let's zoom in a little bit in this interface and see what is all out there. So we are going to focus for this 30 minutes on a very specific set of the Azure Machine Learning Service. So first, we're going to focus on datasets. And this is the place where we can register our datasets. This can be files, this can be CSVs. Everything can be there and all your data gets versioned. We have experiments. Under experiments, you keep track of your training runs. So every time you iterate over a model, it will be visible under experiments. All logging will be saved there, all outputs, all your training script, everything can be found there. Then we have models. So if you're done with your training and you have a model that you're happy with, you can register it. And this is basically like the package manager for models. So you check in a model, you get a version number, and everyone else can connect to that model management, giving the model name and the version, and pull that model out. Then there are endpoints. There are two types of endpoints. The real-time endpoints, and these are the endpoints where you can connect to your deployed models. And there are pipeline endpoints, because you can also create complete machine learning pipelines consisting of several steps. You can publish those pipelines and then you get a pipeline endpoint. Then under manage, we have compute. Of course, we need compute to train something and to run our inference on. And we have data stores. And under data stores, we can manage the connection where our data actually lives. So your data can live in a data warehouse. It can live in on a blob storage. So all your connections are managed there. And the cool thing about that is that all the credentials are managed there under data store. So if you use the Python SDK, you just have to reference to a data store. So no need to check in any credentials again. So when we have our workspace, we have to actually create create some compute. And that can be done by saying, Azure Machine Learning Compute, provision this cluster for me. So here I say, create a cluster with a standard NC6 machine, minimum nodes 1, maximum nodes 6. So the virtual machine size, you have a choice of almost all the virtual machines in your region. So here I say, give me a standard NC6. And a standard NC6 is the cheapest machine that actually has a GPU in it. So this one is around $600 a month. But you only pay for it when it is actually computing for you. So in this configuration, always one is up. So this computer is always running and charging my credit card. But if you say minimum nodes is 0, then it will shut down after 3 minutes of inactivity, and it will spin up whenever it has to do something. And maximum nodes, you can limit how much concurrent jobs you can have. So you create that compute, takes around 15 minutes, and your cluster is there. You can also change these things later. The second thing we need, or the third thing actually, is a place for us to store our data. By default, you will get a default data store. That is a blob storage with a very long name, but you can connect to any other data store in the cloud. So you can connect to any blob devices, don't even have to live within your Azure subscription. So let's have a look at how a workspace looks like. So this is it. There are a little bit more options. So I'll zoom in a little bit. So here we have notebooks. So you have Jupyter notebooks running in the cloud for you. We have automated machine learning. We have a visual designer. And here are the data sets, experiments, pipeline models, endpoints, and our compute. And they just released a cool data labeling tool. But let's go to a Jupyter notebook because we want to see some code. So the first thing we need to do is, of course, import a lot of dependencies. And for demo purposes, I put them all in the top. Then we need to connect to our Azure Machine Learning environment. So I say workspace from config. I've checked in my configuration file. I connect to my compute target, which is called Optimus Prime. And then I connect to my default data store, because for this demo, the default data store is enough. And I connect to my experiment Simpsons PyTorch. So we see workspace Cybertron, compute target Optimus Prime, data store, workspace blob store, and experiment Simpsons PyTorch. So we can all find them back here under data stores. We can find our default data store back. It's just a connection to a blob storage. Under compute, we can find our compute cluster, Optimus Prime. So I have Optimus Prime that has standard NC6, GPU-enabled machines, and Bumblebee is a standard D3 that is a CPU-enabled machine. You can here manage your inference cluster. So I have a Kubernetes cluster where I can later on deploy my models to. And here we have compute instances. This is CliffJumper that will actually run my Jupyter notebooks for me. But I'm now running my Jupyter notebooks locally. So the second thing, we need data. So I will download my data from my GitHub repository. I download it, I unzip it, I remove the zip file, and I start uploading it to my default data store. Because I've connected to my data store here, I can just say data store upload. This is my source part. This is my target part. Overwrite it and show the progress. We're not going to have a look at how I upload images, so I've already done that. And the images are now just on my blob store. So now they're on my blob store, I can create a data set from it. So I say data set, I specify where it can find my data, so on my data store in this directory, and I say create this data set from files and register my data set as LEGO Simpsons V3. So now we can go to datasets here, and we see that there is LEGO Simpsons version 3. I can click on it, I can see how many files are in it, where it is, I can make new versions of it. I can here see how I can actually consume this data set. So it is really cool. They give you examples in Python and they reference you and they give you some links to our docs. And you can easily create and update a new data set. So the cool thing later is that we can actually track back from our model to an experiment to our data set. So we can really find from production, if our model is in production, we can track back to which data set was used to train this model. So now we have our data set, we can actually preview it. So let's run this cell, go to the training data, and here we see that I have 10 different classes of Simpsons. So now we have a workspace. We have compute, and we have our storage. So now it is time to start experimenting with our model and with our data. So first for that, we need to create an experiment. An experiment is the glue that holds everything together. So when we have an experiment, the next thing we need is a training script. And a training script can be basically any Python file. So to be very clear, this is not very specifically bound to Azure Machine Learning Service. So you can use almost all training frameworks that are out there. It is just writing a Python file that will do the training for you. Here you see a Keras file, but we're later on going to just use an example from the PyTorch website. There are some tweaks that you have to do, but I will show those later. So when you have your training file that will output your model for you, you have to create an estimator that is going to execute that training file. So you say estimator, create a new TensorFlow estimator, create a new PyTorch estimator, create a new just a regular Python estimator, and we give it some parameters. So we point it where it can find our training script and our additional scripts. We inject some parameters in it. Here we just use the parameters where it can actually find my data, tell it on which compute cluster it has to run, which script it has to execute it when it is done booting up, tell it if it has to use a GPU-enabled Docker container, and we can tell which Conda packages it has to install, how we can use the Conda package manager, or we can use pip. And we can tell which TensorFlow framework it has to use. And then when we have configured our estimator, we can submit that estimator to our cluster. So we say experiment, submit our estimator. It will create a new run, and we can look in our Jupyter notebook how our run is doing. So it will stream back all the outputs of that run to our notebook. So let's do that. So we have our data, we have our workspace, we have our model. So now we can need to create our training script. And this is a script I just took from the PyTorch website, a beginner's tutorial, how to do transfer learning for computer vision to create a classification model with like limited data. So I copied all of this, and basically I went to the GitHub repository and copied the script and removed some comments and some testing I didn't need. And it resulted in this script. So after copying this script, I added a few things to it. So I added a reference to our Azure ML core package. And I import that it can parse my arguments. So I connect to my current run context. Then I parse my incoming arguments. So where can it find my data? And I made it that I can specify the number of runs, training runs. I parse this estimator. I parse those arguments, and that is it. For the rest, the script is as is. Connect to my GPU, and then in the loop where we do our training runs, I added this. So I say run log my accuracy and my loss. And finally, I added that when it saves the model, it saves it in the outputs directory. So it is very important because this runs in a Docker container on your compute cluster. Your training script is going to create artifacts, but your Docker container will shut down and everything in the container is lost. So if you save everything you want to have saved in your outputs folder, it will automatically copy it back for you to Azure Machine Learning Service, to that very specific run within your experiment. So you say torch save your model file here and the labels. So these two files are now copied back. So we will write out this file, and then we can create our PyTorch estimator. So I have here my two script parameters. So I connect to my name, to my data set, and mount it. So this will now be available as a directory within that Docker container. So my script is just looking at files in a very specific directory. I point to where it can find my training scripts. That is actually where this file lives. Tell it, hey, when you're done, execute this training.py, use a GPU-enabled machine, and install these additional packages because I need some HTML data prep and I need to have Pillow installed, and use version 1.3 for PyTorch. We can create our estimator, and then we can submit our estimator to the cluster. So the first time you do this, it is going to build a Docker container for you. So that will take a little while because it will, of course, create a Docker container and install all these additional packages for you and will register it in your own Azure Container Registry that comes with Azure Machine Learning Studio. The second time when you run it, if you don't change any of these parameters, but just your training script, it will reuse your Docker container. So let's see what's going on, because it should be done very, very, fairly quickly. We see that I have already one node up and running, so we don't have to wait actually for our cluster to boot up. So if you use it, if your node is not running, you have to add like an additional 5 minutes for your cluster to be ready. But here we see it is already running, meaning that it is already deployed to the cluster and it executed our training.py, because it says processing data set here already. It is mounted the data set. And hopefully we'll see. And here it starts downloading the other model. Where does it do that? I don't even see it. Oh, here. Here it starts downloading our model. And now it will start. Oh, it switched log files. So here you see you can follow everything real time what is going on in this container. So here it is now in our training runs, and it starts logging this these values. And the cool thing is if you run .log and your log integers or floats, it will automatically start creating graphs for you. So you see every training run it is actually adding these values. So over time, we can see our model performing. And yeah, this is not that nice for a model, but it is an example on how you can do that. So let's zoom in a little bit what just all happened, because there are like a lot of things that happen exactly at the same time or after each other. So we had an Azure notebook and I've configured an estimator. When I submitted that estimator to our cluster, it snapshotted our folder and send that to the experiment. I will show you later where it is. And then it started created a Docker container for us. It deployed that Docker container to our compute and mounted our data stores and data sets. When it was running, it launched our training script and started outputting all the information to our experiment. And because we have a widget installed in our Jupyter Notebook, we could also follow it real time there. But all the information we saw in our notebook is now also versioned and locked under our experiment. And then when our script is done, it copies over the output to our experiment. So now we have output of our model, of our training. And that is now under the experiment, under the run in the experiment. So now we have to register our model. And we can just say run, register model, we give the name, and we tell it where it can find the where it can find the model files. So let's zoom in a little bit more about what we have now. But it's actually done, so that's pretty cool. So we can use that in the Azure. We can see that from the Azure portal. So there is here a handy link that will bring you to Machine Learning Studio, and we'll actually zoom into that run. So here we see it is run number 20. This is my time. It ran for two and a half minutes. It was created on this compute target. And here we can find that it is using our data set we have just created. So we can click on the data set, and here we can see which training set, which data was used to actually create this model. Now we have to go back. Under metrics, we see everything we have logged using the run.log method. General validation loss and training accuracy improving. Here we didn't log any images. We don't have child runs, but if you have a pipeline, you'll find all your child runs here. And here we can see actually the log that we were just monitoring in the Jupyter notebook. And here we also see our output file. So here we see the labels, and here is the actual model file. And under snapshot, you will find back everything that was in your training directory. In this case, it was only the training.py script that was actually here. So you can connect to previous runs to show it, but now we just want to register our model. And now we have registered version 13 of our model. And I specified like a little bit more information than there were in the slide. So I say the model name is Simpsons PyTorch. The model is located in outputs of that specific run. The model framework is PyTorch version 1.3. I gave a small description. I gave it a tag, like PyCloud Conference. And I specified a preferred way of how you want to run this model. So you need at least one GPU and 2 GB of memory for this model to be actually performant. So you can specify that here. So now we can see our model here in model management. We see, let me zoom out one little bit. Here we see our conference PyCloud. We see which run it is generated. So I can now actually go to the model and track back which artifacts are in there, which endpoints that are deployed. We haven't deployed it, but I can go back to the run and from the run to the data set. So pretty cool. Now we have already 3 steps that are connected with each other. So, but that was a lot of talking. So I actually see if this model is actually doing something. So I have here a small inference script that will load, that will first download the model and then load it in, load in the labels, a small message that will score the model. So we transform it back to the size it actually wants it to. We run it. We check if there's a GPU here, and then we run our inference on it. We run our scoring on it, and we output it in this nice metric. And here we see that the model, and we didn't train it for that many rounds, but for Bart it is doing well, for March, for Lisa not so, for GB, for Summit is doing it. It can use some more training. Some versions of the model are a little bit better, but they only trained for a few rounds. So now that we have our model, we actually want to have this deployed in the cloud. So small recap, we've created an experiment. We got a training file. We wrapped the training file in an estimator. We submitted it, estimated to our AI cluster. And when we were happy with our model, we registered our model. So now step 3 is actually deploy this model into production or dev or test, whatever you want. And for that, we need to have like three different things. We need actually to have the model. We need to have a script that will load in the model and can handle requests, the inference requests. And then we need to have an environment file that will specify how this model has to look. These three combined will be wrapped up in a Docker image, and a Docker image can be deployed to Azure Kubernetes service or to an Azure Container instance, or you can pick it up from the Azure Container Registry and deploy it wherever you want. So first, the scoring.py file. You have two methods that you need to have. You have an init version, an init method that will actually load in the model, because loading in models takes a lot of time. And then you have a run method that will hit by every request, where you just basically want to do some image pre-processing and then do your prediction and then return the results. An environment file is just a conda environment file which tells you which packages you will need to have installed to actually run this model. You combine these ones in an inference config, and then you can deploy those inference config together with the deployment config to one of these two outputs. Deploying to ACI, you can do that actually from your Jupyter Notebook. So you create an ACI config and deploy configuration, one CPU, 1 2 gigabytes of memory, and then you say model deploy to in this workspace, give it this name, this model, and here's the inference config, and here is the deployment config. To AKS, you first have to connect your cluster, your Azure Machine Learning Studio, to Azure Kubernetes service, because it will deploy some more containers and add some security for you. And then basically it is the same. So let's get this thing running in a container instance. So first we need to have a scoring script. The only thing I do is load in the model, torch load, then do some pre-processing on the image that comes in, check if there is a GPU in my cluster, run the predictions, and return the predictions in the API. So that is my score.py. Then I'll create an environment file that will install Azure ML defaults, torch, and pillow for me. I combine those ones in an inference config. I say entry script to score.py, and this is my environment. And then I start deploying it to an ACI. We don't want to wait for like 15 minutes for this ACI to be deployed, so I've already deployed it for you with model version 14. So I say deploy config is ACI web service deploy configuration. So in here I reference to the configuration I gave when registering my model. So I don't have to think about, oh yeah, let's do this. I can just reference to the model. Of course, you can overrule that it is not necessary, but it is there. And then I say ACI service model deploy. Here is your inference config. Here is your deployment configuration. You say deploy. Takes 10 to 15 minutes, and then we can connect to our endpoint. So you can say ACI service, get our scoring URI. And here it actually is. So probably if we do this, it will just throw an error. I don't know. It tells us it needs a URI. That's pretty cool. So probably we want to actually test our endpoint now. So this is how we do it to the Kubernetes service, but I will not zoom into that. So here we will test our API. So I have a text file with all kinds of sample images, and we will post those images to the endpoint. So let's do that so we can actually see that it is working. So I can create, of course, a client that will do these API requests for me, but in the SDK, there is already a function for me. So I can say ACI service run, and then post this JSON to this endpoint. So that is really handy. It saves me like writing this whole other thing. I download the image and I will display them in a grid with the result. And here we can see it is actually model 12 was actually performing a little bit better than the model we just created. So here we see that it can actually detect Lisa and Marge and Homer and Krusty pretty well. So the final thing I want to show you now is that if I go to this model here, model version 12, I can actually see under endpoints where it is deployed. So I can go here to that model. I will find my scoring URI. I can even find a link to my Git repository. And with the commit the last commit, the configuration. There is no authentication at this moment. So I can go also to pipe to the real-time endpoints here, and I can see how I can consume it. So from the model now, I can go back to where it is deployed, where it is living in the cloud, but I can also go back to how this model is created. So this was my presentation on how to do Azure Machine Learning Service for a PyTorch model. So it can run any script, but it will really help you as a team to work together and share your solutions and can track how you came to that model. Because you see this quote on the screen, it's a quote from Satya Nadella, "The future we invent is a choice we make, not something that just happens." And we as developers really have the responsibility to deploy our models in a correct and equal way into the cloud. It is easy to do it now. As you see, in 5 minutes, I can train a model, but always as a group, as a data scientist team, have these things in place because we are the ones that will actually run it and make it happen and work in the cloud. So thank you for that. If you want to read more, go to my blog. The slides have been shared. You can follow me on Twitter. The code is in GitHub. And more tutorials on my blog. So thank you. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.
Thanks a lot, Hank.
You're welcome. It
was a really cool session. I hope people would have liked your session. Really, I have already shared your presentation slide with the participants. So would you like to mention that you are going to give a talk at Cloud Community Days as well?
Excuse me?
Yeah, hello. Hank, can you hear me now?
Yes, this is better.
Yeah, so I was telling that would you like to mention about Cloud Community Days that you are going to speak there as well?
Oh, the on the 18th of June, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that one. Yes, that is going to be great. I will talk with my colleagues. I will talk with Seth Juarez and with Amy Boyd about what machine learning actually is, how it works, and how you can use the Azure Machine Learning Designer. So that will be interesting.
Yeah, we are really looking forward to it, and we'll sync up soon for the conference.
Exactly.
So thanks a lot, Hank, for joining us, for sharing your valuable knowledge and taking some time for the session. So really, thank you, Hank. We'll be having you for Cloud Community Days as well. So requesting all to please register for the conference so that you can see Hank speaking again. It would be in a large scale, and we are looking for some cool stuff like hands-on coding demo and really cool presentations. So thank you, Hank. I'll be syncing up with you. Okay. So Hank, I'll be dropping you from the stream.
Yes. Bye, everyone.
Okay. Bye, Hank.
Bye.